Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much for coming out on what has turned out to be a beautiful summer-like day. I'm Susan Burns, professor of Japanese history at UChicago and director of the Center for East Asian Studies. This talk is a part of the East Asia Lecture Series, which the Center for East Asian Studies co-sponsors with the University of Chicago Library. The series was established in 2016 by my colleague Don Harper, who is then director of the Center for East Asian Studies, and it provides students, faculty, and members of the community an opportunity to interact with academics who are at the forefront of Chinese, Japanese, and Korean studies in the United States and beyond. Center for East Asian Studies faculty members nominate speakers with the aim of allowing our community to hear about new and exciting research in our fields. Since its inception, the lecture series has primarily been devoted to scholarship on the East Asia region geographically defined. But in the last couple years, in response to the many acts of violence and harassment towards Asian and Asian Americans that accompanied the COVID pandemic, CEAS has committed to inviting speakers who work on the intertwined histories of the countries of East Asia, the US, and the world, and to studies of migration and diasporic communities. And here I want to acknowledge the efforts of my colleague, Professor Judith Zeitlin, who took the lead in pushing us in this new direction. So thank you very much, Judith. Now I will turn things over to my colleague, Ken Pomerantz, who will introduce our distinguished speaker. Professor Pomerantz is the University Professor of History, and he works on China, comparative, and world history. Many of you are undoubtedly familiar with Professor Pomerantz's 2000 monograph, The Great Divergence, China, Europe, and the Making of the Modern World Economy, which is required reading for all East Asianists, and which won the John K. Fairbank Prize from the AHA and the World History Association Book Prize. And this was actually the second book authored by Ken that won the Fairbank Prize. His first book, The Making of a Hinterland, State Society and Economy in Inland North China, also won that award in 1993. Professor Pomerantz is a fellow of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, and his research has been supported by a vast number of prestigious grants and fellowships, including the Guggenheim, the American Philosophical Society, the ACLS, the Institute for Advanced Studies, and the NEH. So I'll turn things over to Ken now.
Thank you, Susan, and welcome, everybody. It's a real pleasure to welcome Mae Ngai back to the University of Chicago, where she taught before moving to Columbia in 2006, and where she is the Lung Family Professor of Asian American Studies and Professor of History, and the co-director of the Center for the Study of Ethnicity and Race. She earned her PhD from Columbia in 1998, having received her BA from SUNY Empire State in 1992, and worked as a union organizer in New York before deciding to become a historian. She's a historian of immigration, labor, law, citizenship, race, and the Chinese diaspora, the author of three very important books, and co-editor of another. In addition to her scholarly publications, she's a prominent participant in public intellectual life, with numerous articles in the New York Times, Washington Post, Nation, Atlantic, and elsewhere. She's received grants from the Guggenheim Foundation, IAS, the Library of Congress, SSRC, and a long further list. Professor Ngai's first book, Impossible Subjects, Illegal Aliens and the Making of Modern America, was published in 2004 and won no fewer than six book awards, including the Organization of American Historians Frederick Jackson Turner Prize. The book refocused discussions over immigration in the United States by highlighting the often neglected period of peak restrictions between 1924 and 1965, and the experiences of Asian Americans who were often left out of the frame while attention focused on a more easily celebrated story of the American treatment of European immigrants. But at least as much as it is about the often overlooked immigration stories of this long period, the book is an exploration of ideology, of the ways in which accepted definitions and images of the immigrant, and specifically the illegal immigrant, a category that gained meaning in a context of restrictions, were created and transformed in these years, and the long shadow that those ideas continue to cast today, long after the 1965 Immigration Act undid at least some of the structures of exclusion. As I hope that summary makes clear, and as the acclaim for the book makes even clearer, Impossible Subject was very much a book of American history, which succeeded in the oft-attempted but not always successful project of showing that one cannot understand the supposed mainstream of white U.S. history without seeing who was being pushed to the margins, why and how, and how those people pushed back. But Professor Ngai is here this evening as a lecturer for the Center for East Asian Studies, which is testimony to how much her subsequent work has foregrounded the history of the global Chinese diaspora, tracking, as diasporic history does, not a one-way trajectory from leaving behind an original homeland to eventual full incorporation in a new place, but a story of continuing ties across multiple societies. In her second book, The Lucky Ones, Ngai traces the story of a Chinese-American family across roughly a century, the continuing importance of all sorts of limitations on their integration into U.S. society, and the continuing importance of both material and affective links across the Pacific. In this story, those continuing exclusions and connections facilitate the emergence of what Ngai calls an interpreter class of successful Chinese Americans, whose success, ironically, depends in part upon the very fact that their world is not that of a liberal American dream of full inclusion, not for them, and still less for most of their compatriots. Ngai's newest book, The Chinese Question, The Gold Rushes and Global Politics, further establishes her as a global historian, even as it continues to intervene centrally in U.S. history, winning the Bancroft Prize, the single most prestigious book prize in that field. Published last year, the book places the conflict over Chinese migration to the United States, sparked in large part by the California Gold Rush, with roughly contemporaneous battles in the British Empire, where gold rushes in Australia and South Africa also played catalyzing roles. In all three places, she notes, the eventual outcome of these struggles was a virtual ban on Chinese immigration. And in none of them was it the simple story we sometimes hear and read of employers who wanted cheap labor and therefore were on the right side of immigration, even if for selfish reasons, versus restrictionist workers. Instead, capitalist dynamism and racial exclusion, however much they may look like opposites on the pages of an economics textbook, were in reality deeply intertwined with each other in ways that remain relevant today. But that does not yield a story in which the Chinese are simply passive victims. Ngai tells us just as much about the resilience and ingenuity of members of this diaspora. I confess I haven't yet had the time to read this book carefully. I've glanced at it, but I can't emphasize enough how much I look forward to doing so and how much I look forward to hearing Mae Ngai right now. So let me finally stop and let us all welcome Mae Ngai back to the University of Chicago.
Thank you. What? I have my own. Thank you, Professor Burns and Professor Pomerantz. And thank you to Judith Zeitlin, the East Asian Studies Center, and to Connie Yip for her help with arranging my visit. It's really nice to return to the University of Chicago and to see so many old friends and colleagues and to meet new ones as well. My book, The Chinese Question, is about the origins of Chinese diasporic communities in the West and the rise of the racist movements and exclusion legislation passed against them. I examine the regime of exclusion that was enacted throughout the Anglophone world, that is, in the United States and the British settler colonies, and the struggles of the Chinese immigrants for respect and equal treatment, as well as of China itself in the international community. As has been said, my own background is in United States history and Asian American history. This book began with an interest in the origins of the U.S. Chinese exclusion laws, but it grew to become a comparative and global history. The research and writing of this book posed many challenges, which were at once historiographic, linguistic, and archival. I had to learn about the history of the British Empire, the history of China as well as a history of money. That was a real challenge. Certainly, I remain a novice when it comes to these fields, but through my research and thinking across these fields and in global context, I developed new insights into the Chinese question. I came to understand that the Chinese exclusion policies across the Anglo-American world were not only matters of domestic racism in the formation of nation-state identities. They were also integral to the development of late 19th century global capitalism and the ascent of Great Britain and the United States as global economic hegemons, as creditors and as colonizers, as nation builders and as empire builders. Because China was never formally colonized, the Western powers imposed measures like the unequal treaties and exclusion laws as instruments of colonialism and containment. Exclusion aimed to contain China, to limit the mobility of its people to the West. The book is about the dynamics of race and money, which is trade press speak for colonialism and capitalism, in the late 19th and early 20th century. Chinese exclusion was part of a new way of imagining, organizing, and governing the world. I want to express my appreciation for this invitation to share my work with colleagues in East Asian studies. For too long, Asian American studies and East Asian studies have worked in separate silos. Recent trends in both fields, U.S. transnational migration studies, U.S. in the world, China in the world, and interest in diasporic studies in general, have brought about more conversation across our fields, and I look forward to more conversation with you about those connections. A final caveat, I am aware of and appreciate the trend in Sinophone studies that resist the term diaspora, which suggests a monolithic experience when they are anything but that. I use the concept of the Chinese diaspora to refer to a very specific time and place of immigration of Chinese to the Anglo-American settler colonies from the mid-19th century to the Republican era, which bore wide-ranging similarities and were all part of emergent Chinese identity from the late Qing to the early Republic. The Chinese question was simply this: were Chinese a racial threat to so-called white men's countries, and should they be excluded from immigration and citizenship? Exclusion was a radical idea in the late 19th century because it contravened prevailing norms of free trade and free migration. I locate the origins of the Chinese question in the gold rushes in the second half of the 19th century, focusing on California and the Australian colony of Victoria, and in the early 20th century in gold mining in the British colony of the Transvaal. The gold rushes launched into motion hundreds of thousands of people from the British Isles, continental Europe, the Americas, Australasia, and China. Notably, these were the first occasions of large-scale contact between Westerners, that is, Europeans and Americans, and Chinese. There are three major themes in the book which I'll touch on today. First, I wanted to slay the coolie myth. The idea that Chinese were a coolie race, that is, indentured labor, innately servile and docile, and ruled by despotic masters, was central to the rationale that Chinese should be excluded from the countries of the West because they were a threat to free labor and democratic government. This myth had its origins in the anti-Chinese movements of the 19th century, and it is a major task of the book to disprove the myth and to analyze the reasons for its emergence, popularity, circulation, and I dare say, endurance. To slay the coolie myth required that I first approach it as an empirical question. If Chinese were not indentured workers, then what was their social and labor organization on the gold fields and later? This angle is what led me to a social history of the origins of the Chinese diaspora in the West. Second, I address the coolie myth as a discursive question. How did anti-Chinese politics arise on the gold fields in different national and colonial contexts, and how did they evolve into a global racial discourse? And third, what was the relationship between the exclusion laws in the West, the rise of the international gold standard in the international economy, and China's position in the global economy? The general pattern that I discovered was that Chinese were both part of mainstream goldfield economies, while they also developed their own styles of work and social organization. For example, different ethnic groups introduced methods that became universalized. For example, panning has its root in the batea, a woven basket used in river mining in the Spanish Mesoamerica. And Chinese brought techniques of water management from southern China agriculture that became adopted by others. All gold seekers on the California and Victorian gold fields worked as partners in small cooperative groups and on wages for large companies. These men here at the sluicing operation at the Auburn Ravine likely worked for wages. Like white Americans, Chinese worked with people who were relatives from their hometowns, although village and lineage ties were stronger in the Chinese case. The Chinese favored two kinds of organization in particular. One was the small company headed by an investor manager, typically a local merchant,
perhaps a former gold digger, who hired upwards of 20 men who leased their claims to others.
Another type was the small cooperative.
These were typically 6 to 12 men
who shared all expenses and profits and had no boss.
In Australia, cooperative
groups joined together to work down a creek or gully in a method called paddocking. And this is what you see in this photo here. In both North America and Australia, cooperatives were associated with secret brotherhood societies, fictive kin collectivities that were all associated with the Zhigongdang, which started as an exile group from the Taiping Rebellion in China and spread throughout Southeast Asia, North America, and Australia. Both companies and cooperatives were similar to mining organizations found in China and Southeast Asia. In southern China, placer techniques were used to mine tin and iron sand deposits and also drew from agricultural water irrigation practices. Small companies of full-time miners often comprised of landless and socially marginal types who worked for shares under a manager investor. The cooperatives in California and Victoria bear a canny resemblance to the famous Chinese gongsi of the gold mines of West Kalimantan or West Borneo in the 18th and early 19th century, egalitarian cooperatives that formed on the basis of equal share provision, division. As mining developed, some of these cooperatives joined together into federations, and a few became extremely powerful. Their power derived from the position of the Chinese as a force between the native population and the Dutch colonizers. Those conditions, of course, did not exist in the United States or Australia, so Chinese cooperatives in the New World gold fields remained primitive. In 1904, across the Indian Ocean, Chinese miners began arriving in the Transvaal colony of South Africa, which had been recently annexed to the British Empire. This novel experiment was aimed at reviving the gold mines of the Witwatersrand, then as now the largest producing gold region in the world, and addressing a shortage in native African labor in the wake of the South African War. Between 1904 and 1910, the Transvaal Miner Chamber of Mines imported over 60,000 Chinese to work on the Rand. This scheme was a ticking political time bomb in the post-war context when South African racial politics were still in flux. The basis for reconciliation between whites, British, and Afrikaners remained unresolved, as was land and labor policy with regard to Native Africans. Unlike the independent Chinese miners in North America and Australia, Chinese mine laborers went to the Rand under contracts. Their contracts set wages and hours, forbade them from working in any other occupation or industry, or from owning or leasing property, and required them to return to China at the conclusion of their contracts. But if Chinese mining laborers in South Africa were indentured, they were not docile. They rioted, went on strike, deserted the compounds, and passively resisted their oppressions by simply refusing to drill more than the daily minimum number of inches required of them. Within 6 months, the program faced a crisis of labor discipline and social control. Between 1904 and 1907, nearly 25,000 Chinese laborers, more than one-third of the total who worked on the Rand, were convicted of various offenses, including refusing to work, rioting, staging work actions, deserting the compounds, as well as assault, manslaughter, and murder. Notably, kinship and fictive kin groups also existed on the Rand and were key to organizing resistance among the workers. The coolie trope originated in California, where it drew from the proximate examples of indentured Asian labor in the Caribbean plantation colonies, and especially with African slavery in the American South. The association of Chinese labor with slavery was a kind of racial shorthand that cast Chinese as a racial danger to free labor. It was first used in 1852 by California's first governor, John Bigler, who raised alarm over, quote, the present wholesale importation to this country of immigrants from the Asiatic quarter of the globe, in particular that class of Asiatics known as coolies. He declared that nearly all were being hired by so-called Chinese masters to mine for gold at pitiable wages, while their families in China were held hostage for the faithful performance of their contracts. Bigler called upon the legislature to impose heavy taxes on the Chinese to prevent an indiscriminate and unlimited Asiatic immigration, and for a law barring Chinese contract labor from the California gold mines. What was Bigler's intent? The Chinese in California were not coolies or indentured workers, but Bigler was in a tight race for re-election, and he used the coolie myth to agitate voters in the mining districts where independent prospectors were anxious over the declining placers and the entrance of capitalized deep mining. This was a classic strategy taken from the nativist playbook: appeal to a grievance, offer a theory of racial difference, and weaponize that theory for partisan gain. Within days of Bigler's address, Chinese community leaders responded. Tang Achik and Yuan Sheng hailed from the region in what is now Zhongshan County in Guangdong province near Macau. They were leaders of the Yanghe Association, educated men, successful businessmen, and fluent in English. Tang wrote a letter to the governor. He explained that Chinese in California included laborers as well as tradesmen, mechanics, gentry, and teachers. Quote, none are coolies if by that word you mean bound men or contract slaves, unquote. He added emphatically, quote, the poor Chinaman does not come here as a slave. He comes because of his desire for independence, unquote. Yuan Sheng had been a merchant in South Carolina in the 1820s and was a naturalized American citizen. He made a pointed analysis of Bigler's politics. In a letter to the governor that was printed in the Daily Alta, California's main newspaper, he wrote, quote, you have degraded the Negro because of your holding him in involuntary servitude, and because for the sake of union in some of your states such is tolerated. Amongst this class you would endeavor to place us, and no doubt it would be pleasing to some would-be freemen to mark the brand of servitude upon us. But, he continued, we are not the degraded race you would make us. We came amongst you as mechanics or traders and following every honorable business of life. Yuan further used his own case as a naturalized citizen to refute Bigler's claim that no Chinese made the United States their permanent domicile or applied for citizenship. Tang similarly argued, quote, if the privileges of your laws are open to us, some of us will doubtless acquire your habit, your language, your ideas, etc., and become citizens, and we will be good citizens. In the 1870s, anti-Chinese racism became an incendiary political force in San Francisco, with the Chinese must go being the central demand of the so-called Workingmen's Party. The Chinese question revived in the context of changing economic conditions after the completion of the Transcontinental Railroad in 1869. The railroad did not bring unalloyed prosperity to the Pacific coast. Not only did former railroad workers, white and Chinese, flock to the cities, but the railroad also brought more people from the East Coast, both trends adding to unemployment. The railroad also brought cheap, mass-produced goods from the East, cutting into the market of craftsmen and artisans. Chinese workers were not responsible for these broad dynamics, but they were useful as a scapegoat. And the Workingmen's Party was soon co-opted by the Democratic Party. Eventually, anti-coolism triumphed in national politics, but only after a revision of the Burlingame Treaty with China, which was initially signed in 1868, which provided for free immigration and overcoming the legacy of anti-slavery politics in the North. And here, actually, this cartoon is not an anti-coolie cartoon. It's an anti-exclusion cartoon, which shows Colombia or the Constitution protecting an abject Chinaman from a racist mob, which are caricatured as Irishmen. Chinese exclusion passed Congress in 1882 with a political alliance between the West and the South, two bastions of conservatism and white supremacy in the Reconstruction era. The coolie trope was so ubiquitous in the United States, I was surprised that it was not part of the anti-Chinese discourse on the Australian goldfields. But it would not have had purchase there because the history of bound labor or unfreedom in Australia was not African slavery, but convict transportation of the English and Irish poor. Anti-Chinese racism was more inchoate on the Victoria goldfields. There was no theory of coolieism like the one that had developed in California. More relevant was Australians' insecurity at being a small population at the fringes of the British Empire in Asia, only 400,000 in 1850, who feared being overwhelmed by China's large population. The Melbourne Argus wrote, quote, geographically, we are nearer the pent-up millions of China than any other large tract of country occupied by the white man. We are still but a handful of men and women and children.
The coolie trope entered Australian politics later, in the 1870s.
In Queensland, where whites felt threatened by Chinese and Pacific Islander workers in mining as well as agriculture. Australia posed an interesting case.
Where plantations using cheap colored labor were not on separate island colonies like Jamaica or Mauritius,
but in areas that were contiguous to white settlements in the temperate zones,
areas that whites had staked out for themselves.
In both New South Wales and Victoria, as well as in California, the coolie trope became adopted by white working men's movements in the cities, even though Chinese labor was not, in any of these places, a substantial threat to white labor. The urban labor movement in Sydney and Melbourne adopted the coolie themes from California, which served to rally trade unions to the nationalist agenda unabashedly called White Australia. In South Africa, skilled white workers, skilled white workers on the mines included many Australian immigrants, including the leaders of the British trade unions. They were direct carriers of anti-coolieism and the White Australia policy to Africa. Another source of anti-Chinese racism was in Afrikaner politics, which viewed Chinese labor as a threat to poor whites who suffered from high levels of unemployment and poverty after the South African War. Although Chinese indentured labor was strictly controlled, white South Africans feared they would make their way into semi-skilled and skilled jobs and pave the way for their even greater fear that native African workers would do the same. This was a time when the color line in South Africa had not yet completely hardened. The Chinese question was a problem that complicated the so-called native question, and its resolution, Chinese exclusion, was necessary for that problem to be fully resolved. Chinese labor in South Africa also shot into metropolitan British politics as a key campaign issue in the 1906 general elections in Great Britain. Charges that the Chinese on the Rand were kept in conditions akin to slavery helped to bring the Liberal Party to power, overturning 20 years of nearly continuous conservative rule. It was especially powerful to the Liberals' labor allies, which echoed the abolitionist rhetoric, but which was, in my view, more moved by the question of working class emigration to the settler colonies, which they viewed as their racial and imperial prerogative. So in these ways, the Chinese question and the coolie trope circumnavigated the Anglophone world, starting in California and adapting as it moved across the Antipodes into South Africa and then to metropolitan Britain itself.
To the extent they criticized the so-called slavery of Chinese workers, they did not call for their freedom, for free immigration or equal rights, let alone citizenship. They only called for their exclusion.
This point was not lost on the Chinese. Also traversing the globe were protests and resistance by the Chinese themselves, especially among their merchant leaders and Chinese Christians who tended to be educated and bilingual. Men like and Tonga Chick of San Francisco, who I mentioned earlier, as well as those in Australia.
They were joined by chief diplomats and consular officials who were direct conduits between Chinese communities abroad
and the central government. The Qing consul in San Francisco in the 1880s, Huang Zunxian, worked tirelessly on behalf of the immigrants and was instrumental in bringing lawsuits to protest discrimination, like Tate v. Hurley, the school exclusion case, and Ye Guo v. Hopkins, the Supreme Court decision that struck down San Francisco's discriminatory
ordinance and confirmed that the Equal Protection Clause of the 14th Amendment
applies to all persons, not just citizens. In the last section of the book, I consider the relationship of exclusion policies in the West to China's position in the global economy and in global politics. Most directly, exclusion meant fewer outlets for Chinese merchants and investors in the West. Exclusion meant a shrinking population and therefore a shrinking market, and many of the biggest merchants in California and Australia returned to China or relocated elsewhere. For example, many Chinese retailers left Australia. Some of them founded the big department stores like Sincere in Shanghai or in Hong Kong that developed chains throughout Southeast Asia. This reflected a general trend in which exclusion policies redirected the energies of Chinese immigrant labor and capital to Southeast Asia. The decline in silver prices relative to gold in the late 19th century had a direct impact on China, whose monetary system continued to be based on silver when the gold standard came to dominate international trade. The declining gold price of silver meant that China's imports were costlier, but it also spurred nationalist sentiments among Chinese reformers
who argued that China should develop their own industries and manufacturers and not rely on imports from abroad.
The gold standard also influenced the second major round of war indemnities imposed upon China
around the turn of the 20th century.
The opium war indemnities of 7.5 million pounds were reckoned in silver dollars and taels. After the First Sino-Japanese War in 1896, Japan demanded a 50 million pound indemnity, an enormous increase, and demanded that it be paid in gold. China had to borrow on the international market at a time when silver prices were declining. The indemnity allowed Japan not only to pay for the cost of the war, its cost of the war, but also to establish sufficient reserves to adopt gold as its monetary standard. And its gold deposits in London established the credit for the construction of Japan's first steel mill. The Boxer Protocols of 1901 were even more punishing.
The eight powers, Europe, the US, and Japan, demanded an indemnity
of 67.5 million pounds in gold over 39 years at 4% annual interest.
By 1938, China had paid out over 91 million pounds.
Two American economists writing about China's foreign trade
in the early 20th century made special note of the role that overseas Chinese remittances played in China's balance of trade accounts. Remittances range from an estimated $50 million a year between 1902 and 1914, and double that amount by the mid-1920s. Counted as assets, remittances enabled China to carry a modest net surplus in its balance of trade.
And even as exclusion policies shut Chinese out of
the social and economic mainstream in the West, the immigrants carried gold dust home
in the linings of their jackets or sent foreign exchange through their so-called
jinshan or silver letters. The fluctuating rates of exchange
between gold and silver were not just matters for accountants and financiers. Chinese immigrants followed them as well, and they always knew how remittances sent in foreign exchange would translate to local currency in their villages.
One of the ironies of the Chinese question
is that the overseas Chinese in the United States, Australia, and Southeast Asia held on to their savings and remitted large amounts to China when the price of silver dropped.
Finally, it must be said that the circumnavigation of the Chinese question
was not only the foundation for Chinese exclusion policies in the Anglo-American world.
The Chinese question was also a catalyst for Chinese nationalism
in China, which developed in connection with the politics of diasporic communities. Leading anti-Qing figures like Kang Youwei and Sun Yat-sen actively organized among the Chinese overseas. opposition to the Chinese exclusion laws in the United States led to the famous 1905 boycott of American-made products in Shanghai and other cities, which catalyzed the reform and revolutionary movements that finally brought down the Qing dynasty in 1911. The Republic of China was not able to convince the United States and the British dominions to repeal their exclusion laws. The United States did so in 1943 as a wartime measure, but it kept quotas on Chinese and other Asian immigrations very low. It was only after 1965 in the United States and in the 70s elsewhere that restrictions on Asian immigration eased. In the last 50 years, the Chinese population in the United States and Australia grew with new immigrations that built robust communities. Still, the Chinese question never completely went away. It was always just beneath the surface. In our own time, the Chinese question is tied to anxieties about China's rise as a world economic power. In the United States, Asian Americans make up less than 6% of the total population, yet many white Americans still believe there are too many Asians in the United States and that they are a threat blamed for the coronavirus and myriad social ills. We see the coolie trope repurposed, now embodied in the figure of factory workers in special economic zones in China, and in Chinese international students and Chinese American students in American universities. Both the factory worker and the student are imagined as robotic, who study and work insanely long hours without complaint under the rule of despotic masters, whether it's the Communist Party or their tiger mothers. They are unfair competition because they are not normal like American workers or American kids. As a historian, I do not believe that history simply repeats itself. Racism is produced and reproduced in specific historical and political circumstances. And this helps us understand that racism is not an innate product of the human condition, and that indeed, if it is a political project, it can also be opposed and undone. We always have choices. The great African-American leader, Frederick Douglass, spoke out against Chinese exclusion in 1869. He recognized it as a backward move that threatened the freedom of the former slaves and indeed of all Americans. In his famous speech called The Composite Nation, delivered in Boston in that year, Douglass recognized that migration was a human right. Now, I just find that astonishing that in 1869, he says migration is a human right. He said we should welcome the Chinese, and he was unbothered by the prospect that Chinese immigrants might come in large numbers. Let them come, he said, and let us welcome them, for they will become a part of the nation. Douglass made a prescient connection between domestic immigration policy and imperialistic foreign policy. He said, if the white race may exclude all other races from this continent, it may rightfully do the same in respect to all other lands, islands, capes, and continents, and thus have all the world to itself. Thus, what would seem to belong to the whole would become the property of only a part. Frederick Douglass offered Americans a choice between a society based on democracy and inclusion, or white supremacy, inequality, and exclusion. Sadly, the latter path was taken in no small part owing to the political alliance between the South and the West, which we can consider that lineage to today, right? Where are all the red states in the country, the South and the West? Maybe excluding California, but not even all of California. So we still have a choice. Should we choose a path towards a more inclusive future? Should we stand in solidarity against all racisms? Addressing anti-Chinese and anti-Asian racism today is, in my view, part of a larger struggle in the United States that is unfolding between equality and inequality, between democracy and authoritarianism. So thank you very much for your attention. Okay, Professor Pomerantz is going to moderate our discussion. Thank you.
Thanks very, very much. And please raise your hands and we'll begin.
UChicago.
I was just wondering, thank you for the talk, Mae. I was wondering if you could speak a little bit about the transnational formations that may or may not have connected these communities. So were there print cultures, ways in which migrant workers in South Africa and Australia, in California, were talking across these spaces, strategizing together, and what did those formations look like?
There definitely was a print culture. There were newspapers that circulated. There are people who wrote letters to newspapers in China, which then circulated in other cities. So I found things in Chinese newspapers in Australia that obviously had originated in South Africa. So there is that circulation. I think another source is because most of the Chinese in Australia and California came from the same regions in southern China. So there's also networks of native place organizations. And certainly the Secret Brotherhood Society, the Zhigongdang, had its own network that were transnational. It's a little hard to actually track like people who might have gone between these places. I found a couple. Not a lot, but you know, those kinds of sources are scarce. But there definitely are associational networks, the Brotherhood Societies, a print network. And I think also it's a little hard to pinpoint exactly, but I think the network of among Qing consular officials was another kind of network. I don't know if I'm hardly, you know, an advocate for the Qing, but however, what their consuls abroad, what they meant, because they weren't sent abroad in order to, for the most part, in order to defend Chinese subjects, although they did send the consul to San Francisco for that reason. But in general, they were ambassadors. And they were initially sent out so that the Qing could learn about the West, right, starting in the earlier parts of the earlier 19th century, the 1860s maybe. They wanted to learn about the West and they wanted firsthand knowledge. But these diplomats, as they came into contact with Chinese communities, it altered their way of looking at China's role in the world, right? Because if their subjects were so humiliated abroad, that was a huge, to them, it was analogous to the unequal treaties that the West had imposed upon China. And for the emigrants, it meant that they actually had a direct line to the central government, which they would never have had otherwise, right? So there's a lot of, and some of these diplomats traveled to different, they were stationed in different countries at different times. So I think that's another kind of vector of transnational communication that existed. And I think we need to study that more. So thank you for the question. It's a great question.
Carl.
Thank you for the talk, Dr. Ngai. I'd like to return briefly to the origins aspect of your story, especially in the interest of trying to root Asian studies and Asian American studies. And in particular, the idea of slaying the polymyth, as you put it. I'm 100% with you that it's important to slay this myth insofar as it's with respect to the idea that, you know, gold miners are all coolies, and also with respect to the ways in which this trope was weaponized to fan sort of nativist sentiment in the US and other communities. I'm wondering how your story changes if we don't start it in the mid-19th century. Because if we look a little bit farther back in the early 19th century or even the late 18th century and look at the history of migrations of Chinese and also more broadly Asian individuals to the Anglophone world, to other places where there are colonial colonies and communities, it looks like the coolie story or the description of these migrants as coolies holds a lot more than when we're talking about gold miners in California or in Australia or other places, insofar as they're coming on contracts, they are more or less indentured laborers. You know, to what extent that is enforced or not, it depends on the situation. But there it seems like we do have a slightly different situation going on, and I would imagine that those experiences in places like Mauritius, St. Helena, or even in the Dutch East Indies, do inform perceptions of Chinese migrant laborers later on in the 19th century as well. So I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about how you think your story would change.
That's a really important question, and it's not easy to address. So I think most Asian American historians would, in the past, have said, yes, there were the coolies that went to the plantation colonies, and then there were the voluntary immigrants that went to California. And that is a distinction, because the Chinese that went to Cuba and, you know, other places like Peru, they were indentured, right? But I think that, well, so there's, so I want to say two things. First, the origin story in California and the other Australian colonies is important because it's the first time that there's mass contact between mass numbers of Chinese and Europeans. So in the plantation colonies, you have workers of color, both enslaved or freed blacks and Chinese, but very small numbers of Europeans, right? They're absentee owners of the plantations. So it's a different kind of political culture. And in the port cities like Guangzhou or Hong Kong, right, you have a small number of whites, right, and, you know, a vast Chinese population. So that's a very different power dynamics. Whereas on the gold fields, people are coming together in large numbers and on roughly equal terms. They're all voluntary immigrants. They're all prospectors. They're all trying to make their fortune. And they have a lot of things in common. And in fact, one of the things I say in my book is that it wasn't like all violence all the time. It wasn't like people were fighting all the time. It wasn't all racism all the time. There are people that worked together, and then people who had conflict. And just as whites had conflicts amongst themselves and Chinese fought with each other, the gold fields were, you know, this international contact zone. And it's feverish, it's competitive, etc. Okay, so that's one thing I want to say. The other thing, though, is that I think some scholars are starting to rethink the coolie question in the plantation colonies. They're starting to say, well, yes, they were indentured, but like the people I study in South Africa, they weren't docile. There were labor actions. They had race riots against plantation managers. Some of this is now being studied by historians. And the other thing that's distinctive about places like Cuba or Guyana is that after their contracts are finished, they become freeholders. So they become small farmers or petty traders. They marry into the dominant population for the most part because Chinese, you know, they tend not to bring their wives abroad, et cetera, et cetera. So I think there's also a kind of nascent scholarship of Chinese in the plantation colonies. Evelyn Hudahart is somebody who is pursuing this line of inquiry in Cuban history, that our notion that they were coolies actually obscures a lot of their own activities, right? I was going to say agency, but that's such a fraught term, you know? So I think that the coolie trade as such, you know, was, of course, was roundly criticized by liberals as being like slavery. And of course, much of it was very oppressive. And many people didn't survive the voyage abroad. And they were treated very cruelly. So this is not to say that they, you know, their conditions were good. But I think we have such a stereotype view of what coolies are and what the coolie trade is that it's not enough to just say that in California or Australia they weren't coolies. We also have to look more closely at the so-called coolies in the plantation colonies. And I think that's a whole project. I'm not doing that. I hope somebody else, other people pursue that question. But I think it opens up a lot of our, you know, it should open up our thinking about these issues. So thank you for raising that.
I can't help interjecting something for myself. So I'm wondering, you know, if you look at the Chinese mines in the far southwest of China. you get a kind of hybrid labor form, mm-hmm. where a lot of these migrants, mostly from Hunan, they go for 5 to 7 years, they're not entitled to any wages. If they make it through that period, which of course many of them don't, they then get to either cash out or get a share in the cooperative. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So they go from being quasi-coolies to being members either of the co-op, mm-hmm. or people with a cash stake that they can then take somewhere else, usually back home to Hunan. I mean, I don't think there's any direct link to the people who go overseas, because it's a Hunanese network and a Jiangxi network, not a Guangdong network. But I'm wondering if you've seen any signs of awareness of that kind of hybrid form.
Well, the cooperatives in Australia and California are, to me, I found fascinating. They were more like the Borneo example, where they were equal share cooperatives. And I was kind of looking for them. I was wondering, you know, there's a little bit of evidence here and there, but they were quite prevalent in Australia, where there are better records. Mm-hmm. And you can see in the claims registers, like these huge leather books that have big pages, and you turn them over, and they list all the people who have claims, and the Chinese will have 6 people and will say 161616. Mm-hmm. To me, that's a cooperative, right? So whether or not, I haven't seen anything in the West where people have a period of time when they own nothing, mm-hmm. and then they have to buy in later. That I haven't seen. But definitely the question of shares.
It is not uncommon at all.
I wanted to ask you to look at the gender lens and how, the demographic of this is largely men, but is there a phenomenon of the preclusion of women migrating because it precludes family formation and settlement in the country? How does that work, and is it uniform across this region?
Yeah, that's a question that Asian American historians have talked about a lot, and I don't think that there's a consensus view. I think there's, at one level, there's definitely laws like in the United States, the Page Act, which excluded Mongolian prostitutes, which was a way to keep women out. And exactly as you said, it was a way to prevent population attrition, right, through natural reproduction. But the other side of it is that if it was customary in Chinese immigrant households for the wife to stay behind. And that was a common custom, and it was a way to keep the sojourner tethered to the village, the ancestral village, to ensure that remittances would be sent back. So I think there were both legal exclusions and also customary practices that were very strong. In California, there were anti-miscegenation laws, so Chinese could not marry whites. But in Australia, they didn't have anti-miscegenation laws. So there are records of Chinese who marry English and Irish women. And they have kids. And they tend to be more kind of middle class. They're English speaking. They tend to rise to be leaders in their communities. It's not a large number, but there is a kind of social formation of these mixed race families. That you do not see in California.
Thank you for a great talk. My question is about perception. Could you tell us a little bit about the perception of the non-East and how that's influenced by the repatriating Chinese that you mentioned? They speak about their experience of the coolie treatment. Like, do they speak about these colonies that they've been to in terms of the West or something entirely different?
I'm sorry, the perception of
these places that they've been to, like the mines in Transvaal.
Uh-huh. How the Chinese felt about those experiences? I think that, well, it's hard to generalize, maybe. I think that they, in the gold fields, gold seekers of all backgrounds view themselves as being temporary. There were men, younger, tend to be young men who went, they want to make their fortune and go back, whether it's to Boston or to England or to China. So the idea that Chinese are sojourners was a way to distinguish them from Euro-Americans, but in fact, most gold seekers were sojourners. And some of them went on to other gold rushes. They were called serial rushers, right? So they go to California, then they go to Australia, then they go to Canada. You know, one of the first research projects I did as a grad student in New York was on the building of the New York subways. And in around 1900, I found Cornish workers in New York digging the subway tunnels who had come from the Yukon.
Gold rush. Right, and there's a whole Cornish diaspora throughout mining regions in the world. So these people move around a lot, and Chinese did as well. And so you see Chinese going more and more to Australia in the late 1850s when the hostility in California increases. Right, so then there's an incentive to go to another place where there's also gold. And like Euro-Americans, Chinese, some of them went back home with their gold, and some of them stuck around and formed communities. So I think that there's these patterns of sojourning and settlement. You could make very broad generalizations about immigration in this period of time, that it involved both people who were temporary and people who settled. And then the question was, among the people who settled, how did they sort out, right, who was going to belong, who had rights, you know, who was going to be included, who was going to be excluded, by what means, you know, then all those things play out.
I think a lot of the Chinese, they were like other immigrants. They wanted to
make a better life. They wanted to make some money. They wanted to support their families back home.
And that way they weren't that different than Italians or, you know, Irish, whatever.
But they faced barriers and politics that they were very aware that
of the racism that was involved. They weren't unaware at all, and they fought against it in ways large and small.
Thanks for a great talk. I really need to read that book as soon as possible. I have a couple of technical questions, just following up on what has just been said about migration. One question I have is, who pays for it? I guess, and that's not a question about Chinese coolies versus European migrants, because in both cases, I guess the people who migrate are poor. So somebody probably advances money, and how does that then determine the freedom or not of the people once they arrive in a certain phase?
Right, right. So one of the long-standing tropes in Chinese immigration is the so-called credit ticket. And the credit ticket is believed to have been the instrument of control, right? That they buy their passage on credit at very high interest. And then when they get to California or Australia, wherever, then they're beholden to the creditor, right, which is its representatives in the Huiguan, right, the elites that run the Huiguan, the associations in the New World. Now, that is only partially true. First of all, it must be said that all immigrants bought their passage on credit. The Chinese were by no means the only group that used credit. In Europe, there's a lot of historical work on German and Russian and other, you know, Italians that use credit to purchase their passage. In the Chinese case, the credit was not, it was not an instrument of indenture.
It could not be sold to another creditor, right?
Which is what an indenture would be, right? It could be sold to anybody, and you would just, your debt would just be passed along. It was not transferable.
And most Chinese paid their debts off within...
In Australia, that was said within a year. I never found data in California.
If there was another average time by which they paid off their debts. But Chinese don't like to be indebted.
I'm not sure about that.
Well, they do go into debt, but then they don't like to be kept in debt. So I think that, and in California, the Quaguan leaders, the six companies, had an informal arrangement with the
Immigration officials that if you wanted to exit the country, you had to
show that your debt had been paid off.
So I think that debt was common, but it was also not an instrument of
indenture. Of course, it's
coercive to varying degrees, but I think that it would be, I mean, I think it's part of the Cooley myth
that the Chinese credit ticket
was a special kind of instrument of indenture. Now, how did they go into
credit? How did they get the credit to begin with? It varied?
Sometimes they did not have to borrow money. There were families that
pooled resources to send one or two young men abroad.
Right, so a network of kin would fund
a ticket for one or two, you know, cousins.
Sometimes they borrowed from their own village association, and that was
a big incentive to pay it back, because then the family would be oppressed right at home if they didn't pay it back. And it was not the poorest people who
migrated, right? Migration in general is not undertaken by the poorest.
They cannot afford it. I mean, the poorest end up being sent to Peru or Cuba
as indentured, right, as coolies. The people that go to
California and Australia, they tend to be,
you know, kind of rural proletariat or semi-proletariat.
I read one story of a man, a young man whose
father seemed to have been kind of like a middling farmer.
And he gave $100 to
his son and two other cousins
to buy their ticket to go abroad. So I think it's also not the case that
the very poorest people are going into debt. There's a range of
an array of mechanisms that have money in this place.
I have actually a naive question today. That was really a great talk. Sort of why I don't know how gold rushes work. I don't know why did so many Chinese come on gold rush? You say that they came from all over the world. That seems like it was a particular draw. And if they're coming from southern China, are they coming from mining backgrounds?
No.
So you didn't need to have a mining background.
They didn't, right? And that's not where
you stand in a river and you bend over and
Right, because we heard about the Cornish miners, so that's what I was thinking of that.
Yeah,
so
they were more skilled.
So why and how gold rushes and
That's a really good question. It's not naive at all. It's a really good question. So
the world or
yeah, so what happens in the 19th century
is that more gold is excavated
In 50 years between like 1848 and 1900 than in the past 3,000.
It's a good statistic.
So why is that? So gold is everywhere.
It's on every continent except for Antarctica. It's everywhere. And people have long prized gold because it's rare, it's beautiful, it's pure. It's one of the very few metals that does not rust when it's exposed to air. It doesn't oxidize. And so it's long been a mark of social status for elites, right? And then it also becomes a store of value, right? Because it's valuable, it's a store of value. But it doesn't really become a means of exchange, like money, until the early modern era. And that's a function of states, right? Who have an interest in controlling the circulation of currency, right? But what happens in the 19th century is that Gold may be everywhere, but it's not everywhere, what they say, payable. To get large amounts of gold, you need more than people bending in a creek with a pan. Capital You need technology. You need
immigration. You need large numbers of people. So the kind of gold rushes in our imagination of the hardy 49ers who are, you know, panning for gold, that passes very quickly, and gold mining becomes capitalized.
Within 5 to 7 years, there's a tremendous amount of money. Especially in South Africa, that's deep, deep gold mining. That's like 2,000
underground. That's huge amounts of investment that's necessary.
So the amount of gold that gets produced increases.
So exponentially as a function of capitalism, especially in these frontier regions where, you know, the indigenous people, they always knew there was gold in the streams, but they didn't value it as a money commodity.
Right? It was something pretty, it was something,
you know, that they could adorn, use for adornment, but it wasn't money. They didn't use money in the way that we think of money.
So it's only when gold becomes a money commodity,
and you have the capital and the technology to mine
lots of it at a profit, that it
stimulates all this motion. So
one of the things that this tremendous amount of gold did is it not only
propped up Great Britain
as the premier banker of the world.
Right. But there was also enough gold in circulation that other countries could adopt it as their standard. Right. So before the 1870s, most countries were on a
bimetallic or silver standard. Because there simply wasn't enough gold for everybody to have a gold standard.
You had to have a certain amount of it, right, in your vaults. So
the gold rushes introduce a large volume of gold into the world.
And it's actually not until maybe the 1880s and 90s where you have
the deep gold mining in South Africa and Western Australia
and parts of Canada
that you have this deep gold mining. And that's really, I mean, I find this
fascinating because the deeper you go,
the less gold there is, and the lower the grade.
So, like, you have to, like,
The number of tons of rock you have to excavate to get 1 ounce,
which is worth $20, is amazing. So it can only be done with cheap
labor. And that's where African labor, Chinese labor comes in.
Because to mine enough gold
to really make money and to make the books balance, you have to have very, very cheap labor.
And so, to me, it's something just fantastical about it.
Right, that the amount of capital and human endeavor
necessary to get 1 ounce of gold.
To me, it's fantastical, and it's only something you can understand if you understand
the power of money and capital and
in credit, financial investment, all these things that are driving Great Britain to be, you know,
the world hegemon, and the United States will be behind it.
And so the
so
important is that I also think, and I think towards the end, I think you started answering the question I also had, which was, why this wire chain is coming now at this moment for gold? And are they just being recruited as cheap labor? Is it the magical gold? I mean, you know, my imagination.
Well, in a sense,
the name of the San Francisco in Chinese has gold in it. And we just,
there's Jinshan, and then
it becomes Joe Jinshan when Australia becomes Shin Jinshan, right? San Francisco is Joe Jinshan, right? Old Gold Mountain. And then it got that name when Australia became
a new gold mountain. But they go, like everybody else in the world,
they go to strike it rich. That's, and then later immigrants come, maybe not for gold, to build a railroad or to, you know, do whatever, but it becomes a kind of, if I can say, a chain migration, right, to the West, where immigrants from all over the world are going to these areas that are industrializing, right? So late 19th century immigration globally is really a story about people from the world's, from capitalism's peripheries going to the industrializing centers of the world. And that's true in, you know, agricultural regions in Germany, to Italy, China, right? These are all rural areas that are become connected to not just cities, industrializing cities in their own countries, but then also abroad.
Thank you. I was wondering if you could talk about how you approached conducting archival research for this project, especially, you know, given the geographical scope, and then also maybe you could touch on the kind of variety of materials we're looking at, because of course some of these are really intensely visual, like these, you know, political cartoons, racist caricatures, and there's some photographs, which photography was a pretty young medium, but I'm wondering if you were also sort of trying to trace different financial transactions, so looking at things like receipts, and yeah, if you could just talk about the archival.
Sure. It's different in different places. Like California was actually the hardest place to research because the archives are very scattered.
There's no central archive. You know, the gold rush takes place in 1848, 49, and California has just been annexed by the United States from Mexico, right? And it doesn't become a state until 1850. So there, if you want to look at, like, I was very interested in finding evidence of ownership, of claims, right? In California, there's maybe four or five extant registers, right, in their different places. Whereas in Australia, the colonial government was already well established, right, and had a very heavy hand in regulating the gold fields, so they kept records. And because they did not treat the Chinese as really categorically different than Europeans, they all had to register in the same claims.
You know, they all had to pay the same licensing fee, and so you see those records, and that's where, in some ways, I could corroborate what I saw in California by way of Australia. Patterns more developed there. And in Australia, there's also, like, I use inquest testimonies, because you can go into a database and look up, do a keyword search on Chinese, and you can see all the hearings that were held when they were inquests held on a death in the countryside. And those were informative. You learn about people's relationships and the kind of work to do. And in South Africa, the government kept records because it was a foreign contract labor program run by the Transvaal colony. So there's all kinds of records there. And then there are, like, chain consular files. Those are scattered. Some of them are in Taiwan, you know, some of them are in London, you know, they're kind of all over the place also.
And then there's also the diaries kept by the diplomats.
They were required to keep journals, and some of them were published contemporaneously. Some of them had been translated into English, some of them not. So there was a variety, and those were actually, I mean, I'm not...
I can read Chinese, but slowly. So I needed
help with translating some of these materials. But some of the Chinese materials were really instructive because I found a few, like, firsthand accounts of in South Africa by a local Cantonese who went to work for one of the big mining companies as an advisor, and he ended up quitting, and he ended up writing,
you know, a long piece exposing what happened to the Chinese in South Africa. And it's not that what he said is necessarily
the truth, but it was very different than what you read in the British records, so you have a way to check.
Right, against what another source is saying. So I just use a lot of, the more you, for those of you who are interested in historical research, the more you look at, the more you find,
right?
And the more varied your sources, the richer your research, because you find things that are not in one source, you find in another.
So a lot of it was kind of a social history research project, and then there was,
you know, the political discourse of both whites and Chinese that were in newspapers or printed pamphlets, newspaper articles, that kind of thing.
Yeah,
just
reflecting on your map, as you mentioned, in Canada, the U.S., and England as well, the anti-exclusion laws were dropped during World War II and soon after. I wonder if you could tell us about the South Africa and Australia cases and what's going on in the 1970s.
In the 70s, in Australia, I think there begins to be a kind of slow reckoning
with Australia's place in the Asia Pacific, which doesn't really develop in full. It takes a couple of decades. But, you know, today Australia's identity is as a Asia Pacific nation, right? They don't promote themselves as a British country anymore, right? Although there are Australians who cling to that identity. And Australia and South Africa's, both countries, their largest trading partners today is China. Australia leased the Port of Darwin to a Chinese company for 99 years. That's like incredible to me, right? So I think that there's begins to be a kind of multiculturalism in Australia. There's more struggles for indigenous rights. There are more Chinese living in Australia. So it's a process.
But I think they kind of realize that white Australia is not a good label for its future. And South Africa, I think, is in the 70s.
They begin to, this is the apartheid regime, so they begin to court
Taiwan capital.
Because there's a kind of small club of pariah countries
in the world in the 70s and 80s in South Africa.
It's Taiwan, Israel. You know, they do a lot of stuff with each other, trade-wise and in the international community.
And it doesn't look the same today, but I think in the 70s there were, and some of it also reaches into Latin America, but the so-called pariah countries, they understood that they needed to stick together.
So that was part of when South Africa made very whites in its apartheid structure. They had already done that for Japanese, but the Chinese got the honorary status in the 70s.
Sorry, could I quickly add to that? I was wondering that too, given the fact that these terms like white and color and these systems of segregation are different depending on where you are, how you just approach that from a kind of discursive level. It's very challenging how different people are using terms differently and mean different things at different places.
Well, I think the white folks pretty much knew who they were. And they had an affinity with each other. And, you know,
Australia was very open about a white Australia policy.
In Australia and New Zealand and South Africa, they openly talk about them being white man's countries. In the United States, that's not polite. They whisper it, but they don't say it out loud, right? That it's a white man's country. But there is, the historian James Bellish, who writes about the Commonwealth.
In the United States, he compares the British settler colonies to America as all being kind of frontier
settler colonies based on like a white male identity. And it's curious because he never talks about Chinese as being the object against which they form those identities. But I think there is a kind of affinity And it's about,
I mean, it's really, to me, it's about settler colonialism. It's about the, that these frontier regions belong to the white race.
And they can't fathom sharing it with Asians.
But what's really the difference of white Russia? They didn't really want Greeks and Italians to come after World War II. Then Greeks and Italians are okay.
Yeah, well, that's true in the United States,
right,
too.
Sure.
Right?
Right. Right. But it's
who gets to be white?
Right, but it's part of the story of why not till 73, right? They kind of ran through one more group of whites they could get.
Right.
And then by the 70s, Italy's getting rich. They're running out of places that they can.
What do you do with the fact that so much of this white settler ideology comes from working class organizations? So it's really, it seems to be, I mean, you said something at the very beginning that seemed to qualify this, but from the way I understood your talk, it's the working man party, and it's labor unions, it's the organized white working class that opposes migration, while it is business interests often that are much more amenable to it. What do we do with this, especially thinking about everything that comes afterwards, at the moment we are now?
I think the inflection point has to do with the emergence of wage labor in these countries, right? The transition out of producerism, as we call it, people who are artisans or even farmers.
Who are producers, and this producerist ideology that defines their identity. And by the 1870s, that is eclipsed by wage labor. And what that does is that it kind of draws attention to labor market competition, right? Competition over wages, right? And the problem of
new groups, usually immigrants, working for less. And so it's a question of labor market competition. Now, in the case of the United States, what's interesting
is that, immigration in general meant lower wages
for the immigrants, right? So there's a general pressure on native wages by immigrants. But what the coolie trope said
was that in the case of Chinese, it's permanent. Right, they acknowledged that immigrants
would put pressure on native wages, but they said the immigrants gradually become
like us. And so the attention,
it's all based on a lie, right? The Chinese can, you know, subsist on a bowl of rice a week, right, or something ridiculous like that.
And that Chinese had no interest in higher wages. But in fact, there's plenty of evidence that Chinese
struggled for higher wages, demanded higher wages, went on strike for higher wages.
So this idea that Chinese are a permanent undercutting of white wages is what was crucial in the coolie trope. And then
that became a more generalized racial condition that not just labor, but also their bosses, right, or merchants who would undersell white merchants. So it becomes a more generalized racial condition. But I think it is
a kind of foundation for a racial view of labor market competition. And it's why today people think that Mexican workers are always going to work for less. But they would work for more if you paid them more, right? I mean, that's logical. But there's an idea, right, that
that immigrant labor, and especially Mexican labor, is just perpetually going to be less than white wages. So there's, I think, that this, and that goes back to free black labor, right? Even during the time of slavery, there was a view towards free blacks who worked on their own account or worked for wages, a view that they would undermine white wages. So I think there's always been this racial tension, if not division, among workers. And I think it comes out of a view of labor's fortunes or misfortunes resting in labor market competition, as opposed to what the capitalists do to them, right? I mean, they look at people who make less than them rather than the employers. And that's, I think, that's been an unfortunate constant in American history, at any rate.
No, I think this is the last question, but it's yours.
Thank you for this very fascinating talk. On this wages question, I just want to keep pressing it a bit further, because I know that in the 1880s, like with the anti-Chinese kind of publications, there was this like article by this guy Gompers, Meat versus Rice, and basically talks about like, do we get to preserve the basic standards of masculinity and and health with our meat-based diet, or do we allow these rice-eating people to come over and like allow that kind of standard to merge with each other? So even past the issue of different wages, there's the issue of like different norms around energy use and consumption.
Right.
So that's like one kind of question I have. And then another question I have, which is sort of related, is I guess it's more like these fun facts that I would like you to also have, which is you described this portrayal of Chinese workers as robotic, and the word robot comes from the Russian word for work. So like
It comes from the Czech.
And like 1984 was based off of a Russian novel called We. So like, I guess all I'm trying to say is like, is there this larger like both like material and like almost cosmological problem that is being hashed out here that has to do with the valuation of work?
Well, I think you answered your first question yourself, right? About meat versus rice, right? But I think racism, as an ideological form, is kind of endlessly inventive and also often contradictory within itself, right? I mean, racial stereotypes are notorious for being contradictory and fantastical, right? And it's like many things, you know, that are based on lies, if they're repeated enough, people begin to believe it, right? And they absorb it. But I'm more of a materialist. My view is much more based on the politics and the political interests that are served by racism. Because I don't think racism is like a general human condition, you know? I mean, if that were the case, then we'd all be doomed, right? There'd be no point in having any kind of struggle. But I think racism is produced out of specific historical circumstances, and it becomes a project of certain interests. And this goes back to Jakob's question about the working men's parties. I think part of the formation of a kind of nationalism in the United States is based on a kind of racial identification of the lower classes with the upper classes. And
the Chinese question and other forms of racism serve that interest. So, I think that there's a kind of identity of with whiteness, right? I mean, in Australia, the white Australia policy was robust. Among the trade unions in Australia, and they had hardly any competition from Chinese. but it was a way for them to kind of buy into a nationalist agenda, right? And it was a way for elites to kind of spread the racism around, right? So it wasn't just theirs. So I think there's a lot of political dynamics that begin to unfold that we have to understand in their specificities.
Thank you. That's not an easy question.
I've been told that we have a hard stop at 6:30.